And joining me now is Georgina Beyer. Welcome to you. Lovely
Thank
to see you.
Thank you.
This is very exciting that you've been invited to the Oxford Union with Winston Churchill, Albert Einstein, lots of big names. How do you feel about that?
Oh, absolutely elated. I'm absolutely delighted. It was an invitation that came out of the blue. And I was gobsmacked when that, and it didn't even come to me directly. A friend of mine in Auckland received the email, and he rang me immediately and let me know. And I said, "Are you sure it's not a hoax?" And he said, "No, it's looking pretty genuine."
I mean, you have been a trailblazer in many, many areas. So I guess going there and speaking, what will you be talking to them about? Because it's a very interesting time, particularly with the debate around transgender issues.
Yes.
You were ahead of your time.
I guess I was, and isn't New Zealand just so prone to doing that? Well, they certainly want me to cover my experiences in the political arena as a transgender person and then some of the broader aspects of my colourful life. And I certainly want to give a plug for New Zealand celebrating suffrage 125, 125 years, which I've been doing some panels and things around the country, making a contribution there on that, which is wonderful. We see that's inclusiveness, celebrating diversity, and I'm very fortunate to be a part of that.
Well, tell me about the... How do you compare what is... We're seeing debates now, we're seeing some sections of the feminist community pushing back against transgender in some areas. Words like TERF I didn't even know existed.
Exactly, me too.
but compared to what you experienced coming through and then into Parliament and fighting your corner?
Well, I never needed any particular help for me to be successful in politics. I stood head and shoulders along with any other candidate, and I challenged, I guess, our democracy to see if someone like me, with my background, could achieve in that arena. If you'd asked me in the 1980s if I ever thought that I would be involved in politics, I don't think so. But it was something I fell into, and then what I realised is you were not handed the handbook on how to do this job, so I learnt on the job. I enjoyed local government very much while I was a councillor, and then mayor of Carterton was wonderful because it's sort of right there and you can, you know, and it was a small district, you know, granted. Parliament was quite different. I certainly didn't expect to be successful in winning the seat of Wairarapa to get into Parliament in 1999. But I did, and I think that's a wonderful reflection on the voters, actually, who are able to, or in that electorate at least, who are able to look beyond my colourful past, which was all out there on the table for them to know about. I couldn't possibly expect someone to vote for me and support me unless they knew exactly who
I was.
And
New Zealanders did?
They did.
So are you surprised that we are now in a sort of a world where there are new debates coming in, these new debates?
There is, because the term transgender never existed in my younger days. I think it was a term that became used in the 1990s probably, and maybe into the 2000s more often. And the term transgender, I guess, opened up a sort of a Pandora's box regarding gender identity. And now it's far beyond what people thought. There are those now who believe they're non-binary, there's gender fluid, gender expressive, gender identity, a whole range of things. And I think if law is ever going to be made around this stuff, and I believe there are some initiatives underway, you know, to do that, you've got to draw the line. Or where is the line actually between what is a gender matter and what is a deviancy or
that
a fetish?
That sounds like a pretty difficult line to draw.
It would be an extremely difficult line.
Where would you draw the line?
Well, therefore, I wouldn't want to draw the line. I don't have to. I'm already assured.
But isn't having it slightly vague, if that's not probably a great word, but isn't it good that people can fit where they want to fit in and then there's no kind of pressure? And why can't the people just be whatever they want to be?
Well, that's perfectly correct. Why can't you just be allowed to be who you want to be? As a law-abiding, positive participant in your society, doesn't really, and as long as your life doesn't impact on others and go about it, shouldn't be a problem, but it is. And as you mentioned, these TERFs, and I saw your clip a few weeks ago with Jermaine Greer, etc., like that, I think they're getting a little hysterical about feeling that their gender is under siege. We are transsexual, or transgender, and I'm a transsexual woman. I'm not a biological female. I was born a biological male. that changed. That's the biology of the thing. And that changed for me as I realised that it didn't fit right. But I'm a transsexual woman. I don't claim to be a female.
No, but does the problem not emerge then when you have birth certificates changing and, you know, these sorts of issues where it starts to become, there start to be legal issues around it? And we know, of course, of Penny, who was denied access to a gym initially because she wasn't prepared to, you know, meet the, whatever standard they wanted.
Well, you may recall or not, I had a members' bill in the Parliament when I was there to include gender identity in Section 21 of the Human Rights Act, grounds upon which you cannot be discriminated against. It went over into after the 2005 election and I lost support. It was would have been a conscience vote. I think gender identity is important to have protected for those who want to go for it, but there are other nuances that we are seeing an emergence far more of female to male transgender people and those who firmly believe that they're non-binary. I find that a little hard to sort of accept. I'm probably as ignorant maybe as you are, Corin, about all of these gender things, because these things have emerged very recently and it is confusing. And my advice to the transgender activists these days, if you actually want to get anywhere, you must bring the public along with you, and they need to be sufficiently educated to understand what the hell you're talking about.
Yeah, because it is confusing. I know businesses are confused at times about, you know, unisex toilets, these sorts of issues as well. So it is confusing.
It is confusing. The toilet issue is a very minor one in my view. I don't know why people keep going on about it. You know, unisex toilets, just non-gender specific toilets, they're everywhere, in our homes even. Why it becomes an issue for businesses, I'm not entirely sure from the...
Because they're nervous, they don't know.
I know, and they shouldn't be. And this is where they need to be made to feel far more comfortable about it. And that is up to the transgender activists these days to ensure that that happens. Not just to point the finger and, you know, and just demand and bang the table all the time about what they need and want.
At the end of the day, we are talking about a group that will probably be finding life pretty difficult, won't they? I mean, they do face discrimination, people of transgender, don't they?
Well, yes, but not as much as they used to.
But we should be there should be an empathy.
Look, I get a bit worried about people who wallow in their victimhood, frankly. They have got to move forward and stop being so introverted and looking into themselves. They want to sit there and analyse and overanalyse why it is they are what they are and all of that sort of thing. Actually, just move beyond that, look at the wider society and see that actually we're in a pretty good place here in New Zealand. Don't blow it by getting people working against you.
So bring the public with you. That's the message.
Yes, good message. I think so.
Georgina Beyer, good luck with the speech. Fantastic to have you here.
Cheers. Thank you, Corin.
Nice one.